All right. So the video just ended, and I reached the limit, and I said, "Well, I gotta stop then." And I think, "Well, why should I stop? Why should I stop? Why should I stop? Why don't I keep taping?" You see. And I was just, I ended with this very strongly, and I can just put it this way: I've seen through the whorishness of the situation. And I certainly do not want to continue to put myself in a situation where I'm being pressured by whorishness, because the world is absolutely being pressured by whorishness. Absolutely. It's called the Whore of Babylon in Scripture. This refers to this extreme whorishness which pressures the world to accept victim consciousness by experiencing sensual pleasures. This is what has been taking place in this world severely over the last 50, 60 years. Ever since the pill was invented, that really got this going very severely. But the attitudes were there to do this, absolutely. And as a male, I felt I was absolutely assaulted and beset by whores and whorishness, absolutely. And it was very unwelcome, actually. But we were made to feel like, hey, well, how could you possibly be against this? And what man could possibly be against this? You must be weird or queer or gay or something like that. No, I'm not gay at all. I just don't like being extorted and blackmailed into supporting victim consciousness. And I don't even like sensuality at all, actually. I feel sensuality is really like a way of attacking truth. It's very nasty stuff, sensuality. It's how we try and reward ourselves for our arrogance, actually. And it's a very bitter kind of reward, actually, if you look at it clearly. I mean, yeah, it is. Absolutely it is. All of sensuality is like a bitter, bitter pill. Bitter, bitter pill. Who are we kidding if we think that it's so wonderful? It's not. It's like nails on a chalkboard. So I tried to, you know, withstand this and go against it. And I felt like I was, voice in the wilderness. And the world wouldn't listen to this, wouldn't listen to the severity of it. But a kudos again to some of the hardline Christians and who pointed this out in some degree. I hope they'll accept my forgiveness and apologies to them, you know, for whatever shortcomings that I was responsible for. There's no question about it. And of course, I expect that I will be forgiven. Christians accept a repentant mind. Absolutely. You say, I was wrong. I was mistaken. I didn't stand up as much as I should have, as much as I could have. I was weak, you know, and I have to, let go of that weakness. Absolutely. Because, as they say, a communion of Christians are ex-sinners, you know, are those sinners who are repented and realize that they have a problem they need to overcome, which is their own arrogance. Jesus said, "I came for sinners." That means those who recognize that this whole situation is a dream of their own arrogance. Obviously, the other ones are refusing to admit that, so how could Jesus come for them? They would reject it. So I hope one day that I can be accepted in true Christian society, somewhere, someplace, and having, you know, gone through this and recognized this and seeing that the basic wisdom of that is absolutely valid. You have to be very strict about sensuality. You have to be very strict about this nonsense of victimization. You have to, you know, this is correct. This is absolutely correct. Having lived through now this collapse, this subterfuge, this hostile takeover of this planet by the the snake of cosmic corporate culture. And now I'm recognizing, yeah, they spoke the truth. Jesus spoke the truth. They set things up to help us avoid this situation. This is, the real, strong, strict. There's been a lot of distortions along the way, but that's still no excuse. As I say, it's men, the ones that are really being targeted by cosmic corporate culture, because they're the ones who have been responsible for trying to be very strictly, orthodoxly Christian and insist upon, that we must follow what the teachings of Jesus. It's very important, and of course, so they're trying to be, the push is to subvert them and convert them into victim consciousness, which is then they've been put under this horrid pressure to accept inducements to give up their faith in Jesus and accept victim consciousness. And as again I have said in the previous video, this is a very diabolical trap that men have been put under. If they refuse, what happens is they're seduced and pressured into sexual relations with these whores, and then if they and then the payment is to support victim consciousness. That's what they have to do. And if they refuse to do that, then these whores of Babylon will accuse them of rape, that it was non-consensual. And then, of course, nobody will believe the man. The man will say, no, it was consensual. And they say, the whores of Babylon will insist that it wasn't. And we have many situations where these women will actually hit themselves and bruise themselves and scratch themselves and then claim that they were attacked by the man. And then later on, the truth will come out. They'll admit, they say, yeah, I did it to myself. We just had a recent example of that. It happens a lot. That I, tore my clothes. I did all this stuff to myself and then claim that I was attacked. This happens a lot. There's many, many false accusations, and men are so scared right now of false accusations that they basically have caved in, absolutely caved in. And if a woman, if a female whore of Babylon says, let's call it like a whore, let's not say a woman, let's call it a whore of Babylon. Okay, really. I don't want to insult women by using that term, because a real woman wouldn't do that. But these whores of Babylon will absolutely insist on sex with a man that they target. They actually target men, absolutely. And then they will extort this. They'll do this extortion situation on, and the men now are terrified. They know nobody will believe them, and that if they don't agree, that they're going to be accused of rape. So they go along, and they're crushed. This is what's happening. This is what's happening. It's been happening for quite some time. Now, a Christian woman would never engage in this. And so men feel less, threatened by that. But they're under a lot of pressure to go along with it. And not all women that say they're Christians are actually Christians, by a long shot. So now, the whole diabolical scheme is coming into light now, that the cat's out of the bag. The cat is out of the bag for sure. And this is something I've long seen it. I've seen it the whole way through very clearly, except the threat was so strong not to speak up. Don't dare speak up. And you realize nobody's going to agree with you. You're going to be a lone voice in this world. Very few will agree with you. They're terrified they'll lose their jobs. We're all terrified we'll lose our jobs if we speak the truth here. Absolutely. But I'm at the point now where I say, maybe it's time we speak up, and because the time of Jesus returning is already here, actually. So, Why should we hold back any longer in speaking the truth about what's taken place here? Now, I don't know how I'd survive if, you know, lose my job. I mean, absolutely, I feel I'd lose my job if this was known that I was speaking up like this. Absolutely. Wouldn't be able to support those who depend upon me. So it's a very radical thing to do, to speak truth in this world right now. And of course, anyone that did help support me, they themselves would be then attacked. That kind of thing here. So how dare you support someone who speaks like this, you know, who speaks truth consciousness instead of victim consciousness. So nobody has the guts to support me here. Actually, I feel that way. And how could I get a job if I spoke truth consciousness in the workplace, or let it be known, people, so you're employing them? Oh, you mean you're supporting victimization? Really? That kind of thing. You're supporting someone? No, you know, they have to fire me, or else they would be, you know, lawsuits and stuff. So I'm just hoping that Jesus supports me is my only hope. It's my only hope I've got right at this point. And I'd say, hey, Jesus, any time, let me know that you've got my back on this one. Otherwise, you know, I'm gonna sink here for sure. Yeah. Maybe Jesus was saying, "Well, I was just waiting for you to speak up." You know, he had to come out of the spiritual closet and say, "Hey, I don't support victim consciousness at all. In no way, shape, or form do I support victim consciousness. I support truth consciousness 100%, no exceptions." So maybe Jesus said, "I'm just waiting for you to say that, and now, okay, I'm going to let you know I've got your back," which would be a great thing, because to speak this in this world is like suicidal, actually. I'm sure your friends would counsel you if you asked them, they'd say, no, you may be right, but it's suicidal to say that here. Absolutely suicidal. And from a conventional standpoint, you'd say that there must be, you know, accurate. It is like suicidal to speak truth consciousness now in this world. And I don't hear very many people speaking this here, if anyone, actually. I think most people on this planet have been very intimidated by what's going on. And they're teaching some watered-down version, you know, of this. They're trying to, you know, not be so obvious about it. I believe there are some in this world who are trying to speak truth consciousness. They're not so blatant or direct or honest about it. They try to camouflage it. They try to water it down. They're trying to teach personal responsibility for your experiencing. But they, you know, they're kind of trying to not be too obvious about it. They think they can get along. I don't know what they're thinking, but I don't hear them speaking up about all the stuff that's happening. Say, hey, this is bogus. This is completely bogus. This is an attempt to take over this planet. It's completely bogus. It's victim consciousness. This is a lie. This is a deception. We must not go along with that deception. And I don't know, hear them speaking up for those who have been blackmailed into this, as I have. I know a ton of people have been blackmailed, especially men have been blackmailed by the horrors of Babylon. There's by these special ops forces whose very purpose was to blackmail them. There's no question about it. Especially the men that might want to speak out about this, they absolutely are targeted and blackmailed. There's a ton of men, I believe. I believe that this vast collective of male consciousness here on this planet has been blackmailed and is being silent because of it. Because they're afraid that they can't support their family. They'll be fired. They won't be able to get a job. Won't be able to support their children, their family, all of this. So again, seeing that this situation is so terrible, I hope that Jesus has our back and says, hey, you know, I'll make good on his promise. He's made a dwelling place for us. I would hope that this is so. If those words were accurately recorded in the Bible, that's what he said. I go to prepare a dwelling place for you. There are many rooms in my Father's mansion. If this were not so, I would have told you. So I go to prepare a dwelling place for you, and so that, you know, I may come back and you may dwell where I'm dwelling. I'll take you there, and you will know the way, where it is and how to get there. You will know that. and paraphrasing it, I certainly hope that Jesus has our back, because it's the time to for those who have our back to show themselves, to show their cards that they have our backs here, because we're speaking truth here now. And if we don't speak truth now, it may be too late very soon. It may be too late. And to say this at all, what would be unthinkable in the near future here. You simply would be absolutely suicidal to say this. And so nobody will say it. And so victim consciousness will have prevailed on this planet. And people will be using assertions, you know, spiritual assertions to get a nice house, to get a nice car, to get nice material things. What the hell is that? You know, pardon my French. What the heck is that? Is that really what Jesus is really teaching us? No, he says, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. That's what Jesus is teaching, is absolute freedom. There's no fixation in God whatsoever. Total freedom from all arrogance. Total freedom from all arrogance. That's what Jesus teaches. Jesus isn't teaching us to say, if I just do the right assertions and invoke truth, that I'm going to get that house, or I'm going to get that car, because I deserve that car, I deserve that house, or I deserve this materialistic freedom. You know, this mixed message that is being taught in this world right now that's very prevalent. I don't believe that's what Jesus is aiming for at all. Jesus says, don't lay up the treasures in this world at all. He says, this world holds nothing that I want, actually. Jesus tells you, there's absolutely nothing here in this world that you really want. Guaranteed. So why should we be practicing this nonsense of trying to use those type of affluence assertions? Abundance assertions, you know, the abundance and affluence assertions. Why should we be doing that? I don't agree with that at all. That just gives us more stuff to be blackmailed with, you know, to lose. Because everybody here is under the threat of blackmail. That's the modus operandi of cosmic corporate culture, of arrogance. It's to say, hey, if you don't support victim consciousness, you're going to lose all this stuff. You know, your wife's going to divorce you, and the divorce court is going to claim all sorts of abuse, domestic violence and abuse that should never happen, and then you're going to end up losing the house, the car, all this affluence that you attain. You're going to lose every bit of it. Now, for me, I don't own anything, basically. I don't have any assets at all, so it's pretty tough to blackmail me that way. Got nothing to lose, really. Very little to lose. So what? Who's in a better position? You know, who's really in a better position to speak up? Someone who has so much to lose, or somebody who has nothing to lose? Even this planet, I don't feel I own. I don't feel anything really towards this planet in terms of, you know, value. I don't value it. It's very tacky. The whole place is very tacky. It's like a very kitschy art kind of thing. It's like, yeah, it's funny, it's amusing in a kitschy, tacky sort of way, but it's not what I really want. So if they say, well, you can't have this planet, we're going to make a settlement where you're so terrible, you don't even deserve this planet, I say, fine, great. I got a better one that Jesus has made anyway. They say, you can't stay in this house. I say, I don't want to stay here, so fine, good riddance. I'll come visit here if I want to, anytime I want to, but I don't really want to make this my primary home. Absolutely not. And very soon, people will just say, you're crazy if you talk this way. Well, you're insane. They'll have pity on you. You know, they'll ostracize you, ignore you, and just have complete pity. Like, how pitiful. You know, you need severe help, you know, that kind of stuff. That's what victim consciousness, which is a camouflage of spiritual arrogance, that's what it will do. It will do anything it can. It'll just throw everything against the wall and see what sticks. That's it. So again, calling on Jesus, I hope you have my back, Jesus. I hope you have everyone's back who has had your back. you know, in this world. And I know I haven't had your back very well, but, you know, I understand that you understand it's all about repentance, that you came for sinners. So I'm definitely a sinner, the sin of spiritual arrogance, have been, and trying to repent. And so I hope that I can be accepted on that basis, not on the basis of having perfectly repented, but on the basis of at least going in that direction. And that's what Jesus said he came for, those who are at least willing to repent. Saying, you're sinners, you're sinners, you're sinners. You need to repent. You're still very arrogant. And I can accept that. If Jesus says, you're still very arrogant, I can certainly accept that and say, yes. But I'm willing to keep working on it here. Working on evaporating the continuity fear. Keep working on evaporating the continuity fear. And that's all you can ask from any repentant one. Call it a Christian. And again, a Christian is just a term that means one who has repented and taken the goal of reality as it is as their goal. That's all. Reality as it is. Christ refers to oil. Oil is a symbol of pure spaciousness, unfixated, totally unfixated, which means God. Pure love is totally unfixated. Pure love is the pure spaciousness that is. So to say a Christian means someone who's going towards accepting pure spaciousness, God as it is, instead of arrogantly asserting that it's been changed or we can change it or it's yet to be determined how it is. That's arrogance. So you know, a Christian doesn't necessarily have to mean somebody who specifically follows the teacher Jesus Christ. It does not mean that, actually. It can be anyone who takes the goal of repenting from their arrogance. Anyone who takes the goal of repenting from arrogance and accepting the fact that we can't change reality, that can be termed a Christian. Or you can term it anything you want to term it. It's still the same. Christ means oil, anointed with oil. That's just a symbol of pure spaciousness, but it's not the only symbol you can use for pure, you know, you can use any symbol you want to, really. Symbols don't have any reality of themselves whatsoever. It's just a convenient, it came from Judeo-Christian tradition of anointing kings and queens and real royalty as divine, by anointing with oil, which means symbolizing that they are representative of the divine truth. Representative of divine truth, which is that reality, spaciousness, pure spaciousness, is never fixated. It's never crystallized. It's never suspended in abeyance, so to speak, from what it is. It's never held in abeyance. It's never held in abeyance from what it is. It never changes. It's never changed. It's never pressured, under any pressure to change. You know, it's perfect. It's flawless. It's everywhere equal for all appearances. All appearances are equally supportive, arising in pure spaciousness. There's no difference at all between any appearance and its relationship to pure spaciousness. There's none whatsoever. Now, this might sound like I'm talking like radical Dzogchen. Absolutely. Radical Dzogchen points this out. So does that mean that they can be termed Christian? Sure. Or that is right. Or we could be termed radical Dzogchen. Or whatever, you know, it doesn't, ultimately, the label doesn't matter. It's not that Jesus makes truth true. No, Jesus realizes that truth's always been true, and that Son of God, Spirit, can't change it. That's all. Jesus didn't reconcile us to reality by some magical changing something. No, we've never left reality. We can't. Our arrogance can't. It's non-causative. It's always been from the get-go. It's not that it was causative and Jesus had to do something to render that causation inert. That is not true. It's always been non-causative. Always. It never, ever had any causation upon pure spacious, upon reality whatsoever. Our arrogance, the belief that there's some contest that we can, the nature of reality is yet to be determined, had no effect on reality. Reality was never suspended from being what it is. Never. Not one instant So there's no atonement, no sacrifice needed to rectify anything. There's no rectification that needs to take place at all. Arrogance is non-causative now and is always non-causative, totally. Nothing needs to be rectified. We are still abiding in pure spaciousness. All is same, has the same relationship with pure spaciousness right now. There's total equality right now in God. That is a fact. There's not one exception to this. And it's always been that way. There's nothing that needed to be re-established. Truth never needed to be re-established as true. It never got out of whack. There's never need for any sacrifice to take place. That is all nonsense. It's all arrogance to believe that. Now, this might, you know, be tough for some Christians to take. They think, you know, well, they have to take it. You know, if you're a real Christian, this is what you have to hear. If you really want to be, realize that you don't need to be reconciled to truth. You never left it. You never did anything to it. You were never in any contest to it. You don't have to apologize to God for anything. You never sinned at all against God. You believed that you could sin against God, but you never did. So you have to accept the fact that you can't sin against God. And this is what arrogance refuses to accept. And arrogance says, if I find out that I cannot sin against God, I'm going to destroy myself. You know, well, you can't do that. If I find out I can't annihilate myself, then I'm going to annihilate myself. I'll be so angry, I'm going to annihilate myself. That's impossible. So again, Jesus, you know, time to have our backs here. Time to have our backs here, because what I'm doing is I'm pointing out how severe this situation, this world really is, and how we do need someone to have our backs here. Absolutely we do. Even to the point of another dwelling place, you know, another home. Because, you know, we're going to be very homeless here soon. If you try to speak the truth like this, openly, publicly, not only are you going to be in big trouble, that those who want to listen to you would very, you know, be in big trouble too. And Christians are being assaulted and put under incredible social pressure right now. Social media is like a bully. Is thugs. Social media is like the SS, like a Nazi SS, actually. It's the New Age SS. Stormtroopers, the New Age stormtroopers. Breaking into your ideological house if you dare say anything that it isn't in alignment with what they want to hear. Victim consciousness is what they believe in. And Jesus proved in this world that victim consciousness is a lie. Okay, Jesus has proved it's a lie. We don't have to prove it. It's already been proven. Victim consciousness is a lie. It's nothing but non-causative arrogance. So nothing has to be reconciled. Forgiveness, nothing needs to be forgiven because nothing ever happened. Nothing needs to be forgiven because nothing has ever happened. Now, we'll see what happens. That's great. We'll see what happens. Speaking up like this is like, you know, it's pushing the envelope, saying, hey, you know, can we speak like this in this world? Well, I seem to be able to, but it's only under cover of not speaking up publicly, really, in terms of nobody knows I'm speaking up this way, in my family, in my neighbors, in my town, in my peer group. You know, nobody knows this, in my job, in my all this. Nobody knows it, because if it did, my life would be ruined, in my opinion. I'd be fired from my job. I'd be kicked out of the house. I would be a pariah. I would probably, you know, people would maybe pursue lawsuits, false allegations probably be made against me. And then the blackmail that I was allowed myself to go through to understand what's going on, the blackmailers would come out of the woodwork, you know, and lawsuits and stuff, because I did put myself through. I wanted to find out what's going on here, you know, and so I found out. So I see, I played along with it for a while to see, is this really true? Is what I see, is it really, is this true? And I found, yes, it is. Yes, it is. We are definitely being severely blackmailed. Where you say, go, be like this, act this way, and then later on say, okay, I won't tell on you, but if you agree to support victim consciousness, but if you don't, then I'm going to get you in big trouble. That kind of stuff. This is what happens. And I found out that the Horse of Babylon are expert blackmailers. Very vicious. Extortionist blackmailers. And they're actually encouraging all women of the world to be this way. Very much so through the popular media. Very much so. There's enormous pressure being put on women. Enormous pressure has been put on women of this world. Ungodly pressure, actually. To the extent, I don't know how any woman could stand up to it, really. It's been so severe. And if they don't go along with it, at least they're being told to shut up and don't say anything about it. And the legal system has been distorted and twisted to support all this blackmail. Absolutely. And then the dear excommunicated Pope Francis recently came out and said, hey, the church has got it wrong all along. It wasn't Eve's fault, it was all Adam's fault. And that women have had it right all along. They're the good ones. They're the ones who are telling the truth. They're the ones who are going to help us. I mean, even I don't know if this is true, but the Dalai Lama's report is saying that Western women are going to, you know, save the world. You know, what an absolute, you know, I don't know if that is true, if he said that, or if it did, maybe it was in a, you know, a moment of weakness or something. I certainly don't want to, you know, scapegoat the Dalai Lama for anything. We all say stuff we wish we hadn't said, that is for sure. But now the Pope is basically saying this, that the women are going to save the world. They're the ones who know the truth. This is completely siding with the Horse of Babylon, actually, situation. Totally. Totally. Totally not having the back of Christians, not having the back of Christian men, for sure, not having the back of Christian women, for sure. Totally pulling the rug out from underneath us. This came up in the income equality thing. The Pope, you know, weighing in on that. Okay, this is a very clever camouflage for what's really going on. Very clever. So we're still taping here. Just hold on for just a minute here. There's a little bit of commotion taking place. Yeah, this... social change is used as a camouflage, a facade for this radical ideology that it's really fronting for. So the Pope is an absolute fool for using this issue of income equality to then comment on this idea that it was all Adam's fault, not Eve's fault. We've had it wrong all along. You know, it's just absolutely pulling out the rug from underneath Christianity and Christians. So I excommunicated the Pope, and he deserves to be excommunicated. You know, for the wolf in sheep's clothing is not the good shepherd, and to pull the rug out from under Christians is not being the good shepherd at all. And Christians have every right to speak up if they see a wolf in the sheep pen, don't they? They have every right to speak up. That's why I excommunicated the Pope. We absolutely have the right to do so. And I'm not going to sit around waiting for the cardinals to do so, because the whole situation has been corrupted. That's why Benedict resigned. He realized that the deal had been made with cosmic corporate culture. The Vatican made a deal, and he was on the losing end of it. So he said, I can't keep fighting this. I'm going to die. You know, it's just, I've done everything I can do. What can I say? I think his resignation was a sign to Christendom saying, you know, it's the end of the church age. This is what's going on. It was a signal, very strong. So now we get to find out who has our back. The Pope sure doesn't have the back of Christians. That is for darn sure. The ex-Pope. the fake Pope, you know, really. The fake Pope, you can call him. Not really a Pope at all. It's fake. He did the classic thing. Oh, I don't want to be. No, I don't want to be. I don't want to be the Pope. No, no. Oh, you insist upon it? You insist upon it? Okay. Only if you insist, you know. That's what the cosmic corporate culture does. That's their trick. You know, saying, we're not going to help you unless you really insist upon us. We don't really want to help you. It's a real big problem here. Of course, they fomented the whole problem in the first place. And then only when we insist that they do it, they say, oh, reluctantly, we will agree to that. But, and then boom, 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 boom. And then how can you disagree when you were the one who insisted upon them in the first place, you know? And they said, well, I don't really want to. They said, well, I warned you, you know, this is the trick that they use. That's a trick. Casuistry, it's a specious, you know, very tricky logic. Jesuitry, as they call it, who tend to excel in that. Specious logic. Logic of arrogance, arrogant deviation. That's what we're all loaded down with here. So, I want to find out, you know, if Jesus has our back here. Might as well put it to the test. Might as well put it to the test. I'm not afraid of it. If Jesus has our back, I say, great. You know, I'm not afraid of that teaching, the adamant teaching. No exception to truth whatsoever. All of this is just a dream of arrogance. That's all it is. These are just cartoon figures. All those bodies, everything are just cartoon figures that we're dreaming on this stage of time and space, process and form. That's just like a screen that we're projecting this cartoon dream, cartoon-like dream upon. And then arrogance is totally non-causative. We are still absolutely free. All is absolutely free. Nothing can ever happen to us. It's impossible. There's no such thing as circumstances or situations. Worlds or universes. Nothing is determinate. It's all perfectly indeterminate, meaning we're never bound. The moment never binds us. We're never bound to the moment. We're in the moment, but not bound by it. In the world, but not of it, as Jesus said. I'm in the moment, but not bound by the moment. I'm perfectly free. This moment is not causative at all of the next moment. Reality is totally non-causative in absolute terms. And arrogance cannot change that. When I say arrogance is non-causative, I mean arrogance cannot change the nature of reality, which is this perfect freedom, which is, you can say, that I'm in the moment, but I'm not bound by the moment. Meaning, the moment doesn't bind me to repeat it in the next moment. I don't have to repeat the moment, nor do I have to go on to something different. See, this is the nature of reality. I neither have to go on to a different experience, nor do I have to keep this one. Neither one is true. I can keep this moment repeating for as long as I want, or I can change it the very next moment, and I can continually change the play of moments, or I can decide I want to keep repeating this moment just as it is. I'm completely free to do either one of those. I'm never bound by the moment. The moment is not causative in any way. It doesn't cause the next moment, and it doesn't cause the next moment in any way. It's only I am the one who is choosing the experiencing, not the moment. The appearance doesn't cause, is non-causative in terms of what I want to experience. In the now, but not of it. In the now, but not of it. I'm in the now, but not of it. There's a lot of teaching in the world about the now, the power of now, the now, this. But it is not being pointed out accurately. I feel that you're in the moment, but not of it. We're beyond the now, actually. doesn't bind us. The now, we're not bound by the now. We're not of it. This is what Srinasargadatta pointed out. I am, but I'm beyond the I am. You know, I'm beyond the now, actually, which is true. So be very careful about this now teaching that's being taught in the world. That could be a very subtle trap, actually. I'm in the now, but I'm never of it. I'm always in the now, but I'm never of it. Okay, so yes, I already know that I'm always in the now, but I'm never of it. Srinasargadatta Maharaj, I believe it was enlightened, is very interesting. I heard something about him which most people don't know. He seems to be a very fierce person, because that's when Westerners only came to Srinasargadatta Maharaj in Mumbai after this book by Maurice Friedman called I Am That, which is a transcript of his meetings, after that had been written. And then they started coming to him, and he said, wow, he's so fierce, he's so angry, get out of here, you know, this. Well, that only occurred after people began, he'd actually been meeting with Indians for quite some time, decades. And I think the 50s and 60s and early 70s, and he didn't used to be that way, but people took advantage of him, of his goodness, to such an extent that he actually had to adjust to this and say, hey, I've got to be more severe here. And so he became more severe and more severe and more severe. By the time the Westerners came to him, he was seen to be quite, you know, severe, and he'd catch you right away and say, no, what are you here for? Get out of here. You know, you're not coming here for you know, realization. You're coming here to take advantage, try to take advantage. Get out of here. Don't come back. And, you know, and so he could be very severe like that. But he wasn't always that way, actually. Wasn't always that way. And what he says, you know, he makes it clear that if you make a God of now, he says, well, then you're beyond God, the God of now. You're in it, but not of it, the God of I am. You're beyond that. And we have a hard time understanding exactly what he's saying, but this is the gist of it. You know, this is the gist of it. So, does now have any power? No, now doesn't have any power over us. We have total power over the now. We might take a look, the power over now. You know, we have power over the now. The now never determines what we experience in the next moment. And it has no power but to reflect. It's like a mirror. It has to reflect what we want to experience. But it's not causative. It cannot force us in any way, bind us in any way to what we put in front of the mirror in the next moment. I believe this is what Srinasargadatta was trying to impart. And people, we have so much trouble with this. We try to make a God of now and say, yeah, I'm bound by the now. And he said, no, you're beyond the now. Whatever you say, that's it. He would say, no, you're beyond that. He was trying to awaken us to our true sovereignty and freedom, and not be bound by a concept of it. Now is bound by us, what we are. We're the ones who bind now to what it is. God, you know, binds God to God, so to speak. The now is our servant. We're the master, the now is the servant. Now must reflect what we want, has no capacity to bind us to whatever we're experiencing. The very next instant, it can be something entirely different experiencing, entirely different adventure. We're absolutely free. drinking any of that mixture I made for myself this morning. It's probably completely coagulated. Yes, it has. It coagulates so it won't pour. Well, it barely will pour. I don't know why it does that. There's no berries in there. There's no pectin in there. Well, blueberries. Maybe the blueberries have pectin or something that sort of coagulates stuff. So all of this talk is something that for me, this is what I would want to hear. If I came across Jesus, this is what I would want to hear. You know, this is what I want to hear. I'd say, this. You know, if I'm hearing this, I'd say, oh, this is great. This really paints the right picture. This is what I need to get used to. I'd say, this is what I need to hear. This is what I need to get used to. This is what I need to hear. This is what I need to get used to. Now, maybe Jesus hasn't returned overtly to us because we're still wrapped up in victim consciousness, thinking maybe we want that. And so we feel threatened by him. We'll say, wait, stay away, Jesus. I'm still hoping that I get more treats, you know, from the, I think I can get like all this stuff, and we haven't clearly seen that we're being blackmailed by those who are offering us all these sensual temptations. They're blackmailing us, plain and simple. Plain and simple. And as long as we still crave some of that, you know, we think maybe we can find a way around it. Maybe it isn't blackmail. Maybe this victim consciousness is right. Maybe we can, you know, maybe we can be. And so we'll say, Jesus, you know, so, whoa, don't come in here. Don't bother me. You know, I don't want you to do that yet. Maybe that's it. Maybe that is it. I suspect it is, actually. Because if you're listening to Jesus, you know, all the whores of Babylon will say, hey, you know, hey, ladies, hey, world, hey, everybody. This person's now an anathema, totally an anathema. Spit on them. Don't even give them the time of day. Don't even, they're absolute anathema here, you know. And you say, oh my gosh, you know, no treats. I can't get any treats, you know. I'm cut off from all treats, and then you'll blame Jesus for that. Look what you did, Jesus. They hate me now. And so we're afraid of that. We're afraid of that. So we don't speak up. And we don't speak, you know, we say, Jesus, stay away. If you get close to me, I might start talking like this. And I believe that's why I'm talking like this, because I did have a dream in where Jesus did come back into the world. I experienced it. And Jesus said, is there anyone here who wants to relate with me? I'm now, my attention is totally focused on being here in the world now and focusing. I'm returned. And is anyone, whoever wants to relate with me, I'm focused on relating with you right now. That's my focus. And he says, anyone want to relate with me? And I was thinking like, is anyone raising their hand? I said, wow, what an opportunity. I said, I'm not going to miss this opportunity. So I raised my hand. I said, yeah, I want to relate with you. And he said, okay, great. Let's start relating. So I started relating with Jesus in the dream. So that's probably why I'm actually speaking up like this way now, is speaking truth to the world. Because when you relate with Jesus, you get the truth. And you, wow, it comes out of you. You know, you say, wow, this is the truth. I've been straightening out all these mistakes that, you know, Christianity has fallen into, the Eucharist, the, you know, the literal body and blood, think you're eating the actual flesh, when it's actually spiritual teachings and truth that Jesus told us that is his true body and blood, okay? And that it represents the right practice of the wine is the build up to the wow, and then the wafer is the full stop in the wow. It really represents right spiritual practice, what it really represents. The Mass represents right spiritual practice, reminding us of it and training us in it. And, you know, all sorts of stuff I'm seeing now about Jesus' real message. That he didn't do healing is our faith made us whole. But he certainly reassured us, I got your back, I got your back. You know, you're doing the right thing. So all this is now coming out more directly because I believe Jesus does have my back. And I believe I did spend time with him. And it's so this, you know, emboldens me to speak the truth. This is probably what's taking place. Because I'm shocked by what I'm saying. I say, oh, you can't say that in this world, you know. What are you doing? It's like suicidal to say this kind of stuff. Nobody will listen. I always tell Jesus, nobody's going to listen to this, Jesus. If I say this, nobody's going to listen. And didn't Jesus say to Peter, you all abandon me. You will all deny me. And Peter said, no, you're crazy. We followed you all this time. What are you talking about? I'm very insulted by you saying that. And Jesus said, just you wait. You'll deny me three times before the cock crows in the morning, you know. Before the rooster crows in the morning, you have already denied me three times. And Peter said, there's no way. It's impossible. And then it happened. Exactly happened. So, you know, when Jesus said, who wants to relate with me? I didn't see a lot of hands. I don't know if there are others or not. I don't know. But I know I raised my hand and was relating directly. Because I think people are super intimidated here. They see all of the traits that this cosmic corporate culture, this victim consciousness, is offering. Look at all these traits. All you got to do, you know, the payment is free. Here, have them. All you got to do is support victim consciousness. That's all. And they say, we'll make it easy for you, though. You know, you can just be quiet and just go along with it. You know, oh, you're a Christian? Oh, it's okay. They said, just don't say anything. Just be quiet. And we won't ask you to be a spokesperson for victim consciousness. We just don't say anything. Just be quiet. And, you know, that's all we ask of you. And didn't Jesus tell us that do not hide your light under a bushel? Do not hide it. Didn't he absolutely tell us that we're supposed to speak up? He says, if you don't speak up for me, I don't know you. And what does he mean by that? If you support victim consciousness, you don't know truth consciousness. So you won't know Jesus. So I believe that what's happened is so many in the world have gone along with this, saying maybe I can get some of these treats if I just don't say anything. So many are just not saying anything. They're not speaking up. This is bad. So I'm trying to set an example for those that say, speak up. You know, speak up if you can. And I believe that those who have been blackmailed into being quiet and thinking that they're going to get a little something on the side, maybe, and they're afraid to relate to Jesus. They don't raise their hand. They say no, because if they do, they will feel emboldened to speak up, and at that point, the deal's off with victim consciousness, and they'll feel like, oh, I would have lost all those. I was hoping I'd at least get some of those treats that they have here, some of those glass beads that they're giving us in exchange for our soul, you know, our spirit, our momentum, in exchange for our spiritual momentum. All they're asking us is to give up our spiritual momentum towards repentance. That's all they're asking. And they're offering us these shiny little glass beads. You know, why can't we take that deal? You know, well, because it's a terrible deal. That's why. It's a terrible, 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 terrible deal. You know, it's like coming to the North American Indians, and the Euro capitalists came over here and said, hey, we got these glass beads for you. The Indian says, wow, those are pretty. You want them? The Indian says, yeah, sure, why? Sure. They say, take them. They're free. We're giving them to you. And he says, oh, and the Indian says, well, what do you want? Can we reciprocate? And they said, sure. All we want is ownership of this land here. Indian said, what? Ownership of land? Well, sure, whatever. I don't really know what you're talking about, but if you want to use this land for hunting, oh, sure. Yeah. Hunting and fishing, whatever. They said, no. We don't need much hunting and fishing rights, whatever. We just want to own the title to the land. And the Indian said, well, I don't know if we could give that to you. We don't have any title to the land, but the land belongs to the Great Spirit. But whatever, yeah. I mean, if you want to say that if the Indians thought they were crazy, but they're dealing with lunatics. Ownership of what land? What do you mean? The Great Spirit owns the land. So they thought they were dealing with maniacs, you know. But they're giving them these nice Venetian glass beads, and they'd say, "This is, wow, sure, like, our women like these, you know. They love them." The braves want to say, "Hey, honey, look what I got you. Look at these. Oh, my gosh, yeah, that's wonderful. Put these glass beads on. Oh, look, I look like such a beautiful princess now, you know, and thank you. What did you have to pay for them?" Nothing. I just told these lunatics that, you know, they could have some sort of deed or paper deed to the land or something. I mean, they wanted a piece of paper. And they're laughing. And saying, what fools the Euro capitalists are. Absolute fools. But I mean, if they want to give us the beads, go ahead. And of course, then later on, they said to the Indians, you're on our land. You can't be here. We have this paper that says we own the land. And he says, "What are you talking about? This is a piece of paper. Nobody owns the land but the Great Spirit. He's given us this land for our hunting and fishing." And they said, "Well, we have these guns that say otherwise." And the Indian said, "Well, what do you mean guns that say otherwise? The Great Spirit will protect us." Boom. Whoops. "What's going on?" the Indian said. "I don't understand this. A bunch of lunatics have come over here. Maniacs." And they said, and then the Euro capitalist said, "Well, we'll make a deal with you. We'll put you on these reservations, and you can live there happily, and you can have the Great Spirit there. But we own the rest of this land, and stay off of it." Of course, the Indians are getting the last laugh by getting everyone addicted to gambling and getting all their money through gambling casinos. And they say, "Yeah, well, you know, you got the land, but you were just working for us all along. And are we going to get all the money back through gambling?" Of course, the house always wins in gambling. They always, you know, you own a gambling casino, you're going to get rich. You will get rich. But so this is cosmic corporate culture, you know, with all these gadgets and trinkets and, you know, saying, "Wow, what a great life you're going to be living. And we'll make everything will be automated, and you'll just be able to have all this leisure and travel and cruises and life. The world will be your oyster, you know, and so wonderful. And all you got to do, Christians, is just be quiet. Don't say anything. You know, you don't have to oppose us. Just don't. I mean, you don't have to agree with us and support us. Just don't oppose us. Just don't say anything. You can disagree with us if you want to, but just don't say anything about it. Just play along, you know, just get along. You know, don't be racist, don't be hostile, don't be bigoted, just be quiet. You know, don't oppose us, and everything will all get along just fine. Everything will be great." Until they get that piece of paper, you know, "Hey, what are you doing on my land? What are you doing on my world? We own this world. Get off the world. We don't want you here." Oops. Uh-oh, I forgot about Jesus. Uh-oh, I was quiet. Uh-oh. I mean, this isn't good. This isn't good. Don't worry, though. Hopefully, I certainly hope that those who have been silent can repent and certainly be forgiven. Say, "Wow." And certainly be with Jesus. Absolutely. I certainly understand the pressures everyone's been under. Being here in this world, going through these pressures, I can absolutely understand why people would be silent, why Christians would be silent, why spiritual people all over the planet would be silent. Those who realize that victim culture is a lie of spiritual arrogance, why they would be quiet, because of this ungodly pressure and all these inducements that are being used, these treats, these tricks, sensuality, being constantly marketed. Saturated, this world saturated with sensuality and glamour, and why some people might say, you know, be a little bit tempted and say, "All I got to do is be quiet. I don't really have to agree with it. In fact, I can feel in my heart that it's wrong. But if I'm quiet, everything will be okay for me." We can understand, absolutely understand, why many would do that. Absolutely. So they can absolutely repent of that and say, "Whoops. Got caught in that one, fell for that trick, and I need to get back on the path of repentance." And hopefully we'll have a place where they can get back on track. But I just want everyone to realize that certainly if I'm in that place, you'll have somebody adamantly speaking truths to help you get back on track. To help you get back on track, because there's a lot of spiritual people on this planet who really need to get back on track because they have absolutely gotten off track. Haven't spoken up. Haven't condemned victim consciousness. Haven't condemned victim consciousness. Absolutely condemned victim consciousness. It's absolute sheer arrogance is all it is. Sheer arrogance stands condemned from the very beginning. Because it's non-causative, it's not creative, it's non-experienceable. So it's inherently condemned. So they've not, you know, spoken up enough to condemn it. Understandable that they had positions to lose, you know, that everyone, you know, Christians and spiritual people around the world are now very frightened of losing all their influence and position in the world. And if they're put in a tough place, they say, hey, if I lose my position, how can I really help out? You know? And so if I speak up, I'm going to lose my position. So they think, at least if I hold on to my position, I can try to slip the truth in there a little bit. But you know what? I've seen that doesn't work well. And in fact, with my experience in the Roman Catholic Church, our priest did try to slip the truth in there. Always in his homilies, and it didn't work, and now he's resigning, he's stepping down, actually retiring. Didn't work. You see, if you think you can hold your position of influence and power in the world and teach a compromised teaching, or basically teach victim consciousness and then slip a little, like, yeah, but, you know, it's not that great, or, you know, that doesn't work in this world. It doesn't work. Because you'll be teaching such a mixed message that really you'll just be allowing, telling people, hey, you really have to go along with victim consciousness. There's nothing you can do about it. But you can understand people in positions of influence in the world not wanting to lose those positions and trying to compromise as much as possible to keep those positions. You can understand that. It's a tough position. In my situation, I don't have any position in the world. So there's nothing to lose. I'm already on the bottom. I'm already in the bottom of having no influence, no position whatsoever. So we've got nothing to lose. Maybe Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, they shall inherit the kingdom. Maybe he's talking about those who have nothing to lose, have lost all position here because they spoke truth. Those are the ones who will go to where his dwelling place, because they spoke up. They spoke up and they didn't compromise. But of course, all is forgiven for those who repent. Just get back on track, that's all. And again, it would be easy to do because for me being here, seeing what happened here, I can easily be an advocate and say, hey, yeah, I mean, the pressure was ungodly here. It was absolutely ungodly here. There's no doubt about it. So if someone says, wow, how dare you, you know, how dare you have not stood up and how dare you have compromised, you know, that's just weak, it's terrible. I'll say, no, that's not so. The pressure that can be brought to bear, it can be extraordinarily severe. You're blackmailed. You know, in the past, it's true, the Christians stood up no matter what. They're martyred, you know, imprisoned. They absolutely would not compromise in the slightest bit. But there weren't all these trinkets that tempt them. You know, this world was such a harsh place. They said, hey, I'd be happy to leave here. In fact, thank you. Oh, you're going to crucify me? Great. I mean, the early Christians were like seeking out crucifixion, actually. They said, hey, you want to crucify me? Hey, here I am. Come on. Please do so. They couldn't commit suicide. That was a sin. But so they're looking for any way out. Because this world was such a horrid place. They prayed for the plague. Can I die? Can I please die? But these days, it's not like that. You know, there's so much trinkets and abundance. And oh my gosh, you know, what can I eat tonight? You know, what can we watch tonight? You know, what kind of enjoyment can we get? The world's our oyster. So we're not really in the mood of martyrdom, you know, so much. And that's understandable. So, you know, we cannot judge ourselves according to the early Christians at all. Should not. That's not fair at all. You take any of those early Christians and transplant them into this world, and I bet you they'd sing a different tune. I bet you they would. They'd say, martyrdom? I don't think so. You know, wow. You know, the monks of early Christian monks, you transplant them into this right place here right now and get them into this whole environment, get them going, they'd be saying, wow, look at all these beautiful women. I don't think I want to be crucified. Look at all these you know, lovely people, and look at all these restaurants, and look at all these bars. Well, look at these women dancing in these bars. Wow, you know, they'd say that's really something, and you know, their head would be turned, and of course the whores of Babylon would go up to them, put their arms around them, and say, hey, let me buy you a drink. Come on, let's dance. You know, and they'd say, well, you know, it's not a sin, is it? You know, and then someone said, hey, you know. You need to stand up to that and be crucified. If you stand up for that, if you say no, you'll be crucified. But hey, you know, that's not, you want that, don't you? And they'd say, well, you know, maybe tomorrow. Yeah, absolutely, they would. I mean, they're living in the catacombs. They're starving to death. Life was hell. You know, just famished, diseased, flea ridden. You know, infected with all sorts of illnesses and sicknesses. Their life expectancy was about 30 anyway. Okay, so what do they care if they're crucified at 29? If they're told they're going to paradise anyway, they say, you go to be crucified, you go to paradise. So they say, sure. That was the attitude. Now put them here, all this health care and food and everything we've got here, all these trinkets, you know, civilization now, they'd sing a different tune. Wonderful shower every morning, and shaving, and beautiful clothes, and beautiful people, and places to go, and everything's gadgets, and on and on and on. Health care, perfect health. Oh, wow, I take care of my health. I'll live to be 90. How long I'll live to be? 90? I'll be healthy 90? I'm not going to die at 30 of the plague or something? Wow. They'd say, wait a minute. Wait just a minute. Wait a minute, Jesus. Wait a little longer, please, Jesus. There are so many here sunk in sin. Just a little longer, Jesus. A little longer to get my loved ones in. You know, they'll say, whoa. Jesus will say, who wants to relate to me? And they'll say, whoa, wait a minute, Jesus. I don't quite want to speak up right now because maybe tomorrow. Keep your distance from me, Jesus. I don't want to be your influence to get me to start speaking up this way, because those lovely ladies that were treating me so nicely, you know, they might spit on me and denounce me and actually accuse me of things I didn't do, and I'll get thrown in jail, and I don't want to be thrown in jail because there's so many nice cars. Look at that car there. Wow. I mean, holy cow, there's another nice one. And I can have those cars. I actually can drive one of those cars. Wow. I get to fly where? I get to fly to Rio de Janeiro and sit on the beach and hang out there. And really? I get to do that? I mean, I can fly all over the world. I can trip. Really? I thought I was living in the catacombs. I have to live in the catacombs in the sewer system, actually. I'm living in the sewers. Fighting with sewer rats. I can stay in the nicest hotels. I can wear the nicest clothes. I can have all this stuff, and all I got to do is just, you know, not be so adamant about truth. Says, well, I'll tell you what, Jesus. tomorrow. Come tomorrow, not today. Not today. So let us not judge ourselves too harshly right now, okay? Really. I have a tendency to have done that. And I, this is the first time I really looked at it. I said, God, the early Christians were like a million times better than we were. We're such weak fools here, you know. But the temptations they had were minimal compared to right now. They're like basically out riding a donkey in a desert, you know, desperate to find a well just to live one more day. You know, I might sit down and say, hey, you know, and maybe I'd be a lot happier somewhere else. But now you can just take them into a gross modern grocery store. You know, you have this Christian saying, yeah, I'm going to speak, tell the truth and be crucified. I love that. And then take them into a modern grocery store. Let them take them through all the aisles, you know, and just say, look at this. They say, what's that? Well, you can have it. What do you mean I can have it? Sure. Just go to the checkout, steakhouse store and give them a credit card. All this stuff. What's that stuff? Ice cream. 30 flavors, 20 flavors of gelato, and every, you know, every possible thing you could ever want in this grocery store. Take them to a mall, shopping mall. Take them to every store. And then after doing that for several months of showing them every possible material luxury in the world, let's see what their tune is then. Are they going to then stand up and say, hey, everybody, victim consciousness is a total lie and a total deception. Everyone must repent. Otherwise, you're going to hell, you know, and then be crucified for it. Are they going to do that? Jesus said Peter would deny him three times. Peter said, no, I'm the one who knows you're Christ. I'm not going to deny you. I guarantee it. Even back then, Peter denied Jesus three times. What about now? What about now? Where you, you know, not only are you going to be seized and destroyed now by this culture, but you're not going to have any of these good things, you know, that are here at all. So, you know, could Peter withstand that? They couldn't even withstand that back then. Well, life was miserable. I mean, back then people were begging to be crucified. Absolutely. They said, this place is just hell. Get me out of here. If being crucified means I get to go where Jesus is, let's go. You know, that kind of thing. So, again, bring them into this present world here. And I dare them to be so adamant about speaking truth in the world. So, I don't accept any criticism from previous Christians, you know. You cannot compare eras like that, you know. There's a lot of pressure right now. Basically, with all the artificial intelligence and technology that you realize is coming, that, you know, you've been promised, basically, you know, like a resort, super resort life with just unlimited sensual pleasures and indulgences and super good health for a long, long life, and you know, just wonderful travel and leisure and protection, and, you know, robots will take care of everything. You'll have just, you know, your wardrobe will be unlimited, your entertainment will be unlimited, you know, just on and on and on. I mean, you'll have just like 100,000 channels with entertainment content. Just, you know, whatever you want. So I dare any Christian, you know, to stand up now at this point and speak the truth, knowing that you're not going to have any of that. However, you will have something way better than that, actually. Absolutely you will. In supernature, in the realm, Jesus' realm, nature is so much better than here. And what freedom, what repentance offers you is glory that is beyond anything that we can imagine. So keep that in mind. We have a flow of experiencing that is so absolutely, astonishingly creative and beautiful and fulfilling that it puts to shame any hedonistic, materialistic paradise. Absolutely it does. And of course, all these promises we're being made are only for the higher-ups, you know. And even then, it falls short. But, you know, they'll promise you anything to go along with their takeover here, to vote for them. And to not say anything, to not oppose it. They'll promise you anything. They'll promise you, you know, a palace, huge gardens, golf courses, you know, chefs, all the food you want, a harem if you want it. God forbid. And automobiles, vehicle, transportation, travel, luxury, money, anything they'll promise you just to shut up. Don't say anything. Don't oppose it. You know, they say you don't have to support it, just don't oppose it. Or if you oppose it, just kind of minimalize it, you know. Don't make a ruckus. Don't rock the boat. Don't rock the boat and you'll be rewarded. Of course, the problem is if you meet Jesus, you'll rock the boat. So you miss out on Jesus that way. You miss out. You say, stay away, Jesus. If you get any closer, I'm going to end up rocking the boat here. And I'm going to lose all this future, this wonderful future that's been promised to me. So stay away. Stay away, Jesus. And see, I'm laughing at it because in hindsight, it's all going to be quite funny to us. So we might as well start laughing now because it's going to be hindsight at some point, hopefully very soon. And we'll all have a very good laugh at this, really. We'll say, stay away, Jesus. We'll joke with Jesus. Stay away, Jesus. Don't come close. You know, tomorrow, Jesus says, how could I come to you? You kept telling me to stay away. He said, oh, yeah, I remember that. I did. That's funny. I was telling you to stay away just for those ridiculous, stale, corrupted crumbs that I was being offered. That is funny. Really funny. So we'll have a very good laugh at some point soon. Very good laugh. It will be a source of amusement for us, for sure. The funniness of the thing that we were contemplating, turning our back on you know, on this supernature, Jesus' dwelling place, to think we were, you know, turning our back, thinking about turning our back on this for the, you know, the flesh pots of Babylon, that is hilarious. That will be a never-ending source of amusement for us, actually. That's the kind of humor, you know, spiritual humor that I actually once was seriously thinking about, you know, turning my back on this. Ah, that's what a joke that is. How funny that is. That is just hilarious. Well, the day has warmed up here. I've been taping for 3.5 hours, I guess, now. More than that. And whoa, it's 3 p.m. I have no idea what time it was. No idea. I just felt it's warm. So I had no idea what time it was. And the notion of time has not been in my mind here. Yeah, so, but the notion of hunger is a little bit, not much. I haven't been aware of that. I haven't been really aware of time, space, process, or form during this taping. Not really. Didn't value it. In other words, I'm valuing the truth more than I do lies here. Valuing repentance more than arrogance. But, you know, still aware that we live in this, we're still in this situation of where the world values it so much that I'm not going to, you know, just try and be completely dismissive of it, not yet. So some point I will go in. I'll go in and get something to eat. I'm starting to. If you talk about hunger, then it makes you feel. You become more hungry. That is for sure. I don't want to overtalk and hurt my voice, so maybe I'm going to wrap it up. Yeah, I'm definitely feeling hungry now. as soon as I brought my consciousness to that, now I suddenly, that creates a psychosomatic reaction where the stomach starts producing the stomach acid, anticipating, you know, a meal, and you start feeling hungry. It's amazing what attention can do, right? And the mind can do. I haven't been aware of it at all until I brought my attention to it like that. So, I hope that this is moving along the whole situation of the end times, of Jesus's, you know, overt return. I believe Jesus has returned to this planet. And we need to make it more of overt, okay? Now, again, it's a process. You need to warm up to it. There's a process of warming up to that. Just like this day has warmed up. And I'm trying to play a role in that. And warming the world up to the overt return of Jesus to this planet, and finding out what Jesus has to say, and what our options are, if we have options, finding out if we have options, pragmatic options. Of course, we always have the option to awaken from the dream. Absolutely. That doesn't mean that we don't have also pragmatic options, which would, you know, take us out of severe temptation and blackmail. And all of this pressure that we're under, severe pressure. So hopefully this is moving things along by putting it into context. I say, why have we said stay away, stay away, stay away? Now we're starting to realize, wow, that we'll speak up if we get close. It will speak up, and we don't want to chance that, thinking that maybe we just don't say much of anything, we might still be able to keep our faith and also be able to indulge in, you know, the future here, and trying to have it both ways. So basically I'm saying, hey, forget it, you know, let me speak the truth, and I'm sure something good will come of that. Whatever will come of it has to be wonderful. Just putting faith in that. I'm not aware of anything wonderful, per se. But I just feel that it has to be that way. There's no option. There's no other option. Truth, reality is completely glorious. And so if you're supporting truth and repentance, then certainly that is going to be ultimately what you go towards for sure. And I don't really have a picture of what's going to happen yet, so just let that click in wherever it may click in. But I don't want to risk, you know, not speaking up. That seems to be very risky, because it seems to me very easily you could get pulled into a compromise and blackmail and all this stuff. And not that we haven't already been blackmailed. Many have been, actually. And then threatened, if you ever speak up, we're going to expose you, you know, as a fraud, as a terrible person, blah, 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 blah. Really, you mean, what you mean, expose me as someone who's been blackmailed, is what they really mean, right? They'll expose themselves as blackmailers, is what they'll expose, be exposed. So fine, bring it on. That's what they want. So this is an interesting, very interesting, compelling experiment here in real spiritual politics, and I look forward to how it works out, uploading these videos and posting them on the internet and see what happens. it's, I don't know, I really don't know. Certainly victim culture, victim consciousness would not be pleased in the slightest bit by any of this. But again, we have no choice but to drop our arrogance. No one has any choice without, there's no exception to that. So, this has to be said. And people don't want to hear it, they don't have to hear it. But it has to be said. There's no choice. It's all, the truth is already within us anyway. And this is a time where we have every right to defend our momentum towards repentance. Every right to do that. Every right to defend that. And we certainly are defending it. We're not going to accept trading our momentum and mood of repentance for the trinkets of sensuality. We're absolutely not going to do that. So we are absolutely right to clarify this in our own minds and in the minds of the others who don't want to do it either, and prepare ourselves for removing ourselves from this temptation and pressure, if that's what it comes down to. Absolutely, if that's what it comes down to. So we have every right to prepare. Absolutely do. We affirm this right. And nobody's going to take this right away from us. We're not going to choose to be blackmailed into surrendering this right. No way. Okay, very great. Keep the faith, keep the faith. Now that you hear, you know, the intensity of the faith, you realize, hey, I'm going to keep my momentum of repentance. Absolutely. And I refuse to be blackmailed into surrendering it. Okay? Very great. Alrighty. And now I'm probably going to get something to eat. Don't have to, but I probably will. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.